that. To start our journey into Hamilton's America, I'm going to read excerpts from the funeral oration delivered by Hamilton's good friend, Governor Morris, at Trinity Church on July 14, 1804. Fellow citizens, when the first sound of the American War called him into the field as a young and unprotected volunteer, such was his zeal and so brilliant his service that we heard his name before we knew his person. The penetrating eye of Washington soon perceived the manly spirit which animated his youthful bosom. By that excellent judge of men, he was selected as an aide and thus became early acquainted with and was a principal actor in the most important scenes of our revolution. Shortly after the war, at Philadelphia, he there assisted in forming that Constitution, which is now the bond of our Union, the shield of our defense, and the source of our prosperity. At the time when our government was organized, we were without funds, though not without resources. To call them into action and establish order in the finances, Washington sought for splendid talents, for extensive information, and above all, he sought for sterling, incorruptible integrity, all these found in Hamilton. Ladies and gentlemen, I present Alexander Hamilton.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. When Mr. Martin said that a couple of honored guests would be coming by, I had no idea he had such a loyal friendship here in the area. I appreciate you coming by, and I bet that you have actually heard a little bit about me in your travels. So let me go right out and say it. Yes, I'm a bastard. But that's not the whole story. My father was actually Scottish nobility. I was born in the Caribbean island of Nevis, and then we moved to St. Croix. But my father and my mother were not able to wed because, unfortunately, my mother was divorced and the laws of the day did not permit it. Well, my father did try to make his fortune there on the islands. He was unsuccessful, and so he unburdened himself of his family. Unfortunately, my mother died a couple of years later. And so, alone, I was left to fend for myself. Lucky enough, though, I gained a clerkship, and it was here that my life took off. A clerkship was working for a shipping company, and so I was in charge of the accounting of the office, for understanding the exchange of different currencies, for understanding the economics of the slave trade, the triangle trade, and understanding the personalities of ship captains from around the world. I loved this. I was eating it all up. As a young 13-year-old boy, this was my education. Besides the books that my mother left me, which were books from classical antiquity, where I read the stories of Caesar, read the stories of Cincinnatus, and I dreamed this in connection with the stories of the sea captains that came my way. When my supervisor fell ill and left me in charge of the entire operation at 14, I excelled. I had no problem dealing with the ship captains on an equal level. I knew that I was destined for greatness. I felt this inside of me. At 14, I said, oh, what a want for a war so I can prove myself. But at the time, the only way I can prove myself was through writing. I wrote poetry. I'm a teenager. I wrote sermons. Keep myself and be a good boy. And I wrote articles. It was one such article about a hurricane that came through and the destruction thereof that caught the eye of some of the local patrons. They saw the brilliance in my writing, and they realized that my brilliance would be squandered there on the islands. And so they took up a collection, and they sent me to New York in 1773 to attend King's College, Columbia University. When I arrived, the city was bustling with the cries of patriotism. I felt I had fallen into my own. Now, I've already understood what was going on, even though I never have been to the colonies, because word of the previous decade filtered down to me. You see, 10 years prior, in 1763, that was the end of the French and Indian War. This was the war that kicked the French out, mostly, of North America, but which bankrupted the British Empire. And so the British Empire then taxed us to pay for our own protection and the war which enlarged our holdings. Now, even though we now had the entire continent, French or say the Spanish would claim that being a dubious clause, but nonetheless, the British government said that we could not settle land west of the Appalachian Mountains. And quite frankly, they did this because they couldn't afford to place soldiers out there. You might have heard of the cry, no taxation without representation. It was very popular back then, but it's a bit of a misnomer. You see, the British government started to tax us, but without representation, that means that those who vote are feeling that their voices are not being heard. Well, I doubt but a handful of you could vote. For in order to vote, you've had to have been a male. Men, raise your hand. Okay, and keep them up, over 21, doing pretty good. Okay, own property. If it's not land, if you're a lawyer or whatnot, you can own books, that's property as well. Belong to the Church of England. Oh, no, there we go down. So that's the unfortunate part. So when they say no taxation without representation, that really is the cry of the rich. But everyone followed that cry. Why? The very next year, 1764, with the sugar tax, taxing sugar and molasses. Well, sugar, molasses, makes rum. So now you've just angered, well, basically the rest of the gentlemen. Then, the next year, 1765, the Stamp Act. The Stamp Act now angered everyone who can read, for it placed a tax on paper. So now all of the lawyers have to charge more for contracts and wills because they have to place the stamp tax on their documents. It also angers all the gentlemen playing with playing cards in a tavern. So the king is really trying hard to anger everyone instead of a small slice of the pie. 2 years later, with the Townshend Acts, he places a wide duty on a wide variety of goods. So this really annoys basically everyone, because we did not have a great center of manufacturing here in the colonies. We had a great base of raw materials, and that's why the king was so reluctant to give us up. It wasn't personal. He didn't love us. Mm-hmm. He loved our goods. He loved our trees. He loved our mines. And so the raw materials were his, basically. They were shipped over to England, where the guilds of medieval times prospered to the colonial times, and those guilds basically pressured the king to keep those manufacturing jobs in Great Britain. If you wanted to have a manufacturing job here in the colonies, you still had to have royal permission, the king's charter, to open up, let's say, your furniture making shop. And those were rarely given without favors. And so now placing the Townshend Acts, basically placing taxes on the wide variety of goods, everyone is starting to feel the pinch. Now in the colonies, Boston ends up being a little bit more boisterous than the other colonies. Boston does not like what's going on. Not many people do. But they're really starting to, they're the rabble-rousers of colonial society. So the next year, in 1768, the king is forced to send troops to Boston in order to keep them at bay. This doesn't work that well. And you probably found out about the result the same way that I did, through the very famous engraving by Paul Revere of the Boston Massacre. That engraving came by my desk in St. Croix, where I saw British soldiers firing point blank into a crowd of unarmed colonists. That's how I learned about it. Now, 3 years later, when I'm in New York, I'm starting to feel it. I see the Liberty Pole set not too far from the entrance of my college. And then, a couple of months later, we have the Boston Tea Party. With the Boston Tea Party, the king then closes the port of Boston in the very next year, in 74. Now, with Boston ports closed, something amazing happens. And this really, I felt at the bottom of my heart. For half a world away, colonially speaking, in Williamsburg, Virginia, they decided to have a day of feasting and prayer in solace, consolation for their suffering brothers in Boston. That's amazing. Because we're 13 colonies, 13 separate countries, 13 personalities. A Boston seaman could not be more different than a Virginia planter. But here they are, sharing this in solidarity with each other. And at that point, I realized that we could be united. I wasn't the only one that realized that. That same year, delegates from all the colonies were sent down to Pennsylvania. They met in Carpenter's Hall in Philadelphia. They met there to really talk about the problems that were going on in each individual colony, to share their stories, to see if something can be done. They realized their gripe was true, and they decided to meet again in a more proper footing the very next year, in 1775. And that's when the Second Continental Congress met. Now, the Second Continental Congress, they realized that war was just about to break out and that they needed to create a strong army. And they created that with a Virginian, George Washington, had said, "I love this idea. I'm a very strong proponent for a strong central government and a strong army to protect it." Also in this year, you might have heard about the shot heard round the world at Lexington and Concord. Well, this was the British government going to the small town of Concord outside of Boston in order to retrieve, steal, arms and ammunition from the Patriots. Now, we've all heard about that, but what you might not have heard was the same day, down in Williamsburg, Virginia, the king did the very same thing. They cleared out the local powder magazine. The powder magazine is right in the center of town of Williamsburg. Its purpose is to provide arms and gunpowder at the ready, just in case the citizens of Virginia, which at that time really was half the country, or half the continent, I should say, if they were attacked by Indians, by pirates, by French, by Spanish, by anyone. The king taking that away, that's taking away our protection, and we paid for that in our taxes. So I'm going to digress for a second, for this is when I started to understand one of the growing ideas of our country, the difference between a public good and a private good. Because we really didn't have public goods back then. A public good is something which is enjoyed by the public. For example, your police force, your fire department, your roads. We didn't have that. A police force didn't exist. That's a 19th century invention. We might have had a night watchman, and the really big shutters that close on your windows, I don't think you allow yours to close anymore, but they had a purpose. Keep the world out at nighttime. The world's a scary place. The fire department, they didn't exist, but every house had to have a bucket. You had a bucket, it had your name on it, it had your number on it. If the church bell rang, you, by law, had to take your bucket, go outside, and help your neighbor put out the fire. Now, Franklin realized that there could be something better, and so he starts to, by steps, get us into a public good. He takes the fire department, he creates a local fire department, full of volunteers. And they say, well, we have pumps now. We have technology that we can make pumps and shoot the water up. Let's buy them, okay? We need money, we're volunteers. And so he creates the fire insurance company. And so in order for the volunteer fire department to come and to help your house if it's on fire, you would receive a big metal plaque and you'd stick it on your wall. And if your house is on fire, they would come out and put it out knowing that they would get paid because you paid your insurance. If you did not pay your insurance, but your neighbor did, they'd keep spraying water on your neighbor's house and let yours burn to a lot. That's why you should pay for your insurance. And everyone knew who paid for the insurance, because the plaque is right on the front of the house. So this is a step going into public goods, and I'm a strong believer of that, because we are a nascent society still. We are students of the Enlightenment. We are still just starting to figure things out, and I have a lot of ideas. So the year is now 1775. We've had the shot heard around the world. We have the Second Continental Congress who have met, and it takes them a year to finally declare independence. With that most beautiful of documents, or sometimes are called the King's rap sheet. The third of it is basically just complaining about every bad thing that the King has done to us. But what it does is it declares our independence. And at that moment, again, something special happened in America beyond what the document said. We celebrate the day that we said we're independent. Other countries celebrate the day they won their independence. Keep in mind, when we said we were independent, no one believed us. A third of our country were patriots. A third of our country were loyalists. And the other third were on the fence. They could go either way. Or they just wanted to stay out of the troubles and just relax and be a farmer. Now, so we tried to raise money. Ask the Dutch for money. No, you have no credit. You're not a country. You're going against the world empire. Good luck, we're not going to give you anything. Spanish, no way, Jose. The French would not join our cause until 1777 with the Battle of Saratoga, where we defeated the great army of gentleman Johnny Burgoyne. The French now realized that we actually could win, so that's when they joined our cause. So it's very interesting that that day survives, not the day that we won it. We scarcely even tell anyone of that day. But at that time, we knew that we were going to celebrate that day. Washington said that July 4th should be celebrated with pomp and with fireworks. And it is still true for today. But unfortunately, right after we declared independence, our great general then proceeded to lose every single battle. As New Yorkers, you probably know that we lost the Battle of Brooklyn. Washington was hurried out of there, trying to keep as much of his army alive as they crossed over the East River to Manhattan. And that's where I met him. Now, I was a young artilleryman. As a student in King's College, I came up with these great ideas that I put my pen to paper and I told everyone about it in the local newspapers. As a student, back in 74 and 75, I was gaining some notoriety as being of the cause, a son of liberty. But I realized that the cause was being a little bit too zealous in how it manifests itself in society. There was one night when an angry mob went to tar and feather the president of my college, Dr. Cooper. He was a loyalist. I completely disagree with him, but I disagreed with the mob as well. I disagreed that mob rule should rule the day. And so I stood up in front of his house, giving him time to escape outside a back window as I held the angry mob at bay. Doing this when I was scarcely 15 years old. Now at this time, I realized that I can do so much. I'm here in New York. You can do anything that you want in New York. So I want to be an artillery captain. I'm not going to let the fact that I don't have any cannons stop me from being an artillery captain. And so I gain a bunch of my friends and I say, let's form an artillery company. And so we get some very nice uniforms. We start parading outside of King's College and we do it so well. And eventually an opportunity does provide itself for us to obtain some cannons from Battery Park. And it's here where I first show my bit of bravery to more of the public, as there were British man-of-war ships angry that we were stealing some of their cannons, were firing at us, but I walked so calmly over to retrieve my musket, not being fazed at the lights and the resounding booms that they were trying to harm us. Some people say that was foolish, but those people don't understand my nature or heroism. So when Washington saw me now, in 76, being the young artillery captain, his army is fleeing through Manhattan, going up north, basically running away, running for our lives, and here I am building an earthenwork fort with my troops, getting my cannons ready to protect the general during the retreat. He sees me, and it's the first meeting. He calls me over just to have an introduction. I'll never forget the day that his high gaze came down upon me. He has about 9 inches on me, the general. But unfortunately, as the retreat resounded throughout Manhattan, then up to Fort Washington, and then Fort Lee, as we lost every single battle, I was able to use my cannons to slow the British down. So I did some good, but we eventually lost the cannons. And then we made our way through the entirety of New Jersey as we were literally chased for our lives, finally finding sanctuary on the other side of the Delaware River. And it is that place in early December of 1776 that we realized that the great cause of independence is fast fleeting from our grasp. How dare we think that we go up against the greatest world empire? How dare we think we have this chance? Combined with the fact that our army is about to disband, vast majority of them have only signed up for a 1-year enlistment. Come January 1st, 1777, they're gone. They're going back home. Would not blame them. We've lost every single battle since we signed the Declaration. But Washington, being the great general that he is, he comes up with a plan to attack, and they would not think we would. Now, the British weren't there. Oh, they're too hoity-toity. They're not going to fight in wintertime. They actually went back to New York, but they held us in such disdain that they left a small contingent of Hessian soldiers in Trenton, New Jersey. Now, Hessians are hired mercenaries. They're the best of the best. That's all they do. They are guns for hire. They kill very well. They are very highly trained troops. Washington knows that they are going to have quite a party on Christmas Day, going into Christmas night, and they're going to eat their fill and drink their fill and probably sleep in late on the cold day of December 26th. And so that night, we crossed the Delaware River. We planned to get there by 6 a.m. We didn't. We crossed the river fine, but it was a 9-mile march till we got to Trenton. We weren't there until 9. I got my hands on another cannon, and I set up my cannon at the head of King Street in Trenton, and simultaneously we started a bombardment and a fight with these hired mercenaries. And here we are, being degraded as farmers with pitchforks, but we defeated them without a single American losing their life. That's providential. That's amazing. So we did it once, but can we do it again? While the British now come on down to Trenton to basically finish us off. And so what do? We come up and we attack their rear guard in Princeton. In 2 weeks, we have changed the course of this whole war. We have defeated the British on their own ground in Princeton. Enlistments were high. Morale was high. The cause of liberty, once again, seems obtainable. In 1776, after the battle, now it's January in 77, Washington, for the second time, sees my actions under fire. And he now calls me into his service as his aide-de-camp. This is both a blessing and a curse. Because as a, dare I say, bastard immigrant, I know that I have to make life for myself. I have to make it happen. And at 14, I said that I wish for a war to prove myself. Well, I have the war. I have my command. I have my cannons. I can make it a go. And here Washington takes me out of the field. But it's a blessing because now I am being treated like the son to our great commander. I become his pen. I become his mouth. I become his mind. I am the one who's writing all of his letters. And unfortunately, during this time, I also understand one thing about American government. It is horrible. I gained such a disdain for the Continental Congress. You see, the Continental Congress was not a strong governing body. Yes, delegates from all the colonies were sent there, but for them to actually make a ruling, they had to agree in unanimous agreement. Most of them are lawyers. When's the last time you saw 13 lawyers agree on something? That's not going to happen. But there's also no power to tax, no power to raise money. And so the actual funds that are coming to us to fund the war come from the states. And so I can't send a letter to the Congress. I have to send a letter to all the governors of every state saying we need money, we need troops. Well, North Carolina, not to pick on them too much, but most of the fighting was up north, and so the southern states were thinking, why should we send you money and troops? We're going to hold it in reserve for just in case the British come down here. So unfortunately, during the winters of Valley Forge, winters at Morristown, I see great suffering and death, unnecessary death of American patriots, American boys, who should have lived if only the Continental Congress gave us our money and supplies. And this would stay with me forever. It helps to build my idea about what the ideal America can be. And in 1780, I actually write a letter and say that we should create a Congress or a convention to supplant the Articles of Confederation. This is something which actually did not come to fruition for 7 years later with the Constitutional Convention. The very next year, though, I finally get what I want from Washington. I actually had to quit his service. I was like, I'm done. I don't think he realized how great I am. And so he eventually realized that he gave me my field command, and I led the charge against Redoubt 10 at Yorktown. This was the last fort, the last little redoubt, an earthenwork fort, before we could completely shell Yorktown into submission. Yorktown, of course, being the last major battle of the Revolutionary War. So I proved myself during that battle. I was declared a hero as I was first over the parapet with my musket unarmed, or I should say it did not have shot inside, for fear that one of my 100 men might trip and shoot off a ball to alert the British inside the fort that we were coming. And so we ran up this earthenwork fort, which had wood spikes sticking out, and up and then into a pit of over 200 British soldiers just with a bayonet, and I led the charge. No one can say that I was not heroic. So, with that now under my mantle from 1781, and with the realization that the war is basically over, the British now have lost two great armies, and the wish for Britain, the citizens of Britain, they don't like being taxed now to pay for this war again. They have grown weary of this war. For us, it was a war of attrition as well. We wore them down. Peace was eventually settled 2 years later with the Treaty of Paris in 1783. Does anyone happen to know the date?
No.
Yeah, we don't care about the date when Great Britain realized that we were free. We don't teach that date to anyone. That's why you don't know it. It doesn't matter to us. July 4th, the day we said we're independent, that's when we were independent. not the day the rest of the world agreed with us. So that is part of the American confidence, which still hopefully persists to today. Now, with the war being over, I go back to New York. I have a law practice there, quite successful. Actually, a lot of my clients happen to be loyalists, like Mr. Martin, whose house you're enjoying. There's a lot of claims by loyalists about who owes what now that the British have left New York and that other parties are coming back in. So, great need of lawyers, and I am one of 35 in the city. So I'm quite happy about all of this. But at the same time, I am still putting pen to paper, trying to get a convention, trying to get the idea that we should have a new form of government put out there. And eventually, enough of the weakness of the Articles of Confederation, it just becomes apparent to everyone. You see, at the time, imagine, every state had its own currency. Every state had its own power to tax. If you're sending goods from New York to Boston, they're going to go via the post road. And when you go through Rhode Island, Rhode Island's going to say, welcome. Are you going to stop off, have a cup of coffee? No. Well, nonetheless, you still have to pay your tax for your goods. It's a customs duty because we're a separate country. We're a state upon ourselves. So this just simply cannot continue. Granted, also with the idea of there's no federal judiciary. If you have a problem with someone, like you have a patent, and you have an invention, and somebody just copies it, well, you take them to the New York Supreme Court because they copied it in New York. Well, then someone in New Jersey copies it. Then you have to go to the New Jersey Supreme Court. And if they vie against you, well, then you've lost. You can't appeal it to anyone else. And then do you have to do that in 13 different states? This doesn't make any sense. So five colonies send a total of 12 delegates to Annapolis in 1786. And they all go yes. Changes have to be made. And so in 1787, the Grand Convention meets in Philadelphia, as you know it as the Constitutional Convention. They were sent there with the idea that they were going to change, augment, add to the Articles of Confederation. Now, I was sent to this convention as one of the delegates from New York. Unfortunately, my political rival of the day, the governor, did not like me at all. My father-in-law was General Schuyler, and I married well. He and General Clinton, or Governor Clinton, did not get along as well. They were political adversaries. And so the governor actually sends two of his best friends to go down there, and they have completely different opposing opinions than me. So unfortunately, my voice is not recorded at a vote because I am one of three, and they always outrank me. But they do not stop me from talking. And I meet someone when I was there, a gentleman, about an even inch shorter than me, always dresses in black, very stoic, James Madison. We become very good friends. James Madison has the same ideas that I do, that we need a strong central government, a strong army. We need to have a strong currency. But Madison, he's actually a bit of an academic. He has studied every single ancient society upon their laws and upon which governments work for small governments, big governments. So he is a perfect companion to my great orations that I make during the Constitutional Convention. But the convention was basically set apart with two dueling factions, which still exist today. Who wins out, small states or big states? Now, when it comes to the federal government, is the federal government going to be the biggest state and have all the power and take away all the power from the small states? Or the small states and all the states still going to have some power? All these questions are going through our minds. But look at it from our point of view. From the Articles of Confederation, each state had one vote. So, little Rhode Island and Delaware, one vote each. The great Virginia and Pennsylvania, one vote each. You might have 20 times as much population, but the same vote. That's simply not fair. And so Madison comes up with the Virginia plan, basically giving a vote based upon population. Eventually that's countered with the New Jersey plan, and eventually a compromise is made which creates what we have today, or something similar to what we have today. I actually was a proponent for the king, president. I'm often basically chided at being a monarchist, thinking that our leader should be a king. Maybe it's because of slip-ups like that. Our president should be elected for life. Kind of like a king, but not like a king. But on good behavior, and the Senate as well. Thinking that if you're there for life on good behavior, you do something bad, we'll replace you, then you're going to be working with the best thoughts of the citizens involved, not for yourself. That was my idea. Eventually, the lower house of Congress, the House of Representatives, was done by population. That's part of the compromise. The Senate was done by state. So each state had two votes. So the smaller states were happy about that, and it's the upper house. Originally, the senators were actually elected by the state legislatures, not by the people. And the president has great power. The president is the check and balance. I wanted him to have an unconditional veto over all of the laws made by the Congress, but that was then brought back to the Congress could override our veto with a two-thirds vote. And that still exists in your time. To tell you the truth, a lot of the ideas that I had, I didn't want them to go into play. If you want 7, you don't ask for 7, you ask for 10. So a lot of what happens, basically, judge me by my actions, not by my words, I often say. And so eventually the Constitution is agreed upon by those in Philadelphia. 12 of the 13 colonies vote yay. One colony doesn't vote yay. New York, my colony, my state. Because actually the two other gentlemen, they got fed up and they left. So I didn't have a quorum. You had to have two representatives from the state in order to vote. And I was there alone, so I could not vote. I, the man who helped write Madison wrote it, but I gave him the words I will take credit for. I gave him a lot of the ideas, and I basically helped it into fruition, eventually being ratified by all the states. I did so much for it, I technically didn't vote for it. I did sign it, though. I asked the general if I could sign it, and he let me. So my name is on the Constitution. Another interesting thing about the Constitution. It starts off as we the people. It's a bunch of basically gentlemen who are creating it, but how do we rectify that with we the people in order to form a more perfect union? Trust me, the Articles of Confederation were not perfect. It's better, but nonetheless, in order to rectify this, we then had all of the states decide upon whether or not they want to accept it or not. We gave a lot of power to the states. They can do it by popular vote, they can do it by their state legislatures, but we're giving it to the people. It's not just us 55 men together there that's going to decide the country. The country will decide upon the country. Second interesting thing about the Constitution, which says a lot about who we were as a country at the time. It is dated in two manners. At the very end of the Constitution, it says, ratified here on this day of our Lord, 1787, and in the year of our country, the 12th. You see, 76 was another marker in the ground. And a lot of publications kept that. Almanacs kept that. Newspapers kept that. In the year of our country. That kept going for quite a while. Now that we've agreed upon it, though, the states are up to whether or not that they are going to accept it. This is where, once again, I put pen to paper. I'm joined by a couple of friends, John Jay, little James Madison, again, my stoic friend who dresses all in black. It's like he's constantly going to a funeral. I don't understand why he does that. He never smiles, too. not very fun at parties. But we are friends. We decided to write a collection of 25 essays under a nom de plume of Publius. We don't want to publicly say it's us this way, that people who have a qualm against us would take a qualm against what we write. So we're putting it out there as pure information. At the end, John Jay, he writes only 5. In his defense, he got sick. Madison wrote 29 essays, but I penned 51 in a 6-month period. These we collected together. They were originally printed in New York newspapers, but they are collectively known as the Federalist Essays. They have been bound and then sold, hopefully still to today. If you want to gain an insight into how we thought, it's the essays of the Federalists. Because you're reading our defense of the creation of America. You're reading our words on what we actually thought. And the Federalist Papers came about really as a retort to the qualms of the Anti-Federalists, or the Republicans. They were still known as Anti-Federalists at the time. So they basically, everything that they did not like about the Constitution, we retorted, and eventually we won out. Eventually, we gained the ratification of the Constitution. So now that we have a Constitution, and the Constitution basically is a 4-page document. If you have not read it, it's kind of boring. It really is what the government can do. That's all it explains. It explains basically what America is or what the federal government can do. If it's not written in those 4 pages, then it's not for the federal government. Because we go back to that duality that still exists in your time, the power of the states versus the power of the federal government. Who controls the elections? Who controls the taxes? Who controls the laws that affect the citizens? The state or the federal government? Don't forget, we are the United States. And so, it comes to play. We work through the document, and we create our government. Of course, the first president, George Washington. The first Congress is elected as well. And we also create our Supreme Court, which is the third part that I really, really pushed for, with John Jay becoming the first head of the Supreme Court. Now that we have this, the president, Washington, chooses his counsel. So in choosing his counsel, he chooses me to be the Secretary of the Treasury and Thomas Jefferson to be Secretary of State. Now Jefferson, which is quite funny, being that Jefferson and I are adversaries, Jefferson actually did not run for nor know that he was going to be Secretary of State. He was enjoying life in France for a great many years. They were start to have a French Revolution. He was writing their new constitution. He, being the perpetual academic, was loving life over there. He speaks French very well, meshed with their society, but he had to come home, and when he arrived into Annapolis, he received the letter, "Congratulations, you are now part of George Washington's cabinet. You are the Secretary of State." But he served for a term. Back in the day, or back in my time, the person with the most electoral college votes was president. The person with the second most votes would be vice president. Oh, imagine how that would be today. And so Adams, who was the first vice president, he knew that he was not going to be president. He knew that Washington was exalted. There was an idea of treating him almost like a god, the apotheosis of George Washington. But Adams knew that his time would eventually come. So in the cabinet, though, this is where I'm able to really grow with my power of what America can be. Because my ideas, as really the strongest federalist, I believe in a strong federal government. I believe that in order to have a strong federal government, you need a strong currency. In order to have a strong currency, you need to have debt. In order to have this all protected, you need to have a strong national army and navy. Yeast, you be taken over and the whole thing collapses. So, I then go about to, I use the clause in the Constitution which says that we, the federal government, can do anything which is necessary and proper for the running of the government. Well, we need money. So I then create a little army, but a force of tax collectors to collect money for the federal government. A lot of our taxes was actually customs duties at the time. So in order to collect all the customs duties, you have to have, sometimes you have to convince people that they really have to pay. And so we create an actual force, which then eventually became the Coast Guard. I created that. In doing so, I believe that we should have a strong central bank. Because I believe that every American has the right to grow into whatever they can dream. I'm living proof of that. But if you have a rich man with a chest of gold and it's sitting in his house, what good is that to anyone else? Take that same chest of gold, it's his, put it in the bank and lend it out. So we need to have a national bank. I helped start the first private bank in 84, but now I started a, by the way, it's a Bank of New York, first stock ever traded on New York stock market. And then now we create a national bank. And with this national bank, we can lend money out short term. Nothing against the farmers. This was nothing against Jefferson's idea of a agrarian utopia that he wanted to create. But giving out 30-year loans to farmers, that ties up the money for too long. Short-term debt is good. Lend it out for 3 months. Lend it out for six, a year at most. And always have the means to pay it back. Do you hear me on that? Have the means to pay your national debt back. Let that one get ahead of you. So I was able to do this. I'm so lucky that Washington gave me the broad powers. Eventually, I had 600 people under my employment as Secretary of the Treasury. Jefferson had six Secretary of State. So we can see where the power lied in this government. When Washington eventually stepped down, he said he simply does not want to run anymore. He actually said this the first term. After 4 years, he said he was not going to run anymore. He wanted to go back to Mount Vernon to simply be the gentleman farmer. But we basically pleaded with him, telling him that there was more work to do. If I lose my benefactor now, a lot would go for naught. And so I need him to run again. The country needed him to run again. And he did run for a second term. But then after that, he said, I really am going back to Mount Vernon. And so after two terms in office, he left, voluntarily giving up power. This is, again, another American tradition. This is recorded in the ages and shall be remembered 1,000 years hence from now. We call Washington America's Cincinnatus. That was the Roman general who put down the sword to become a farmer, and then once Rome was attacked barbarians again, he put down the plow, picked up the sword, and then defeated the barbarians and then left. He went back to being a farmer. The exact opposite of Cincinnatus was Julius Caesar, who brought the troops to Rome and basically said, hello, I am the great general. I have 10,000 troops behind me. I want to be your Caesar. And they said, you do have a lot of troops. How big is your crown? Washington gave up that power, not once as general, but twice as president. So he left office in 1797, left us with a tradition of two terms in office, something which did not become law until your century, the 20th century. But maybe fateful that he did, because he actually died 2 years later in 1799. If he would have taken the third term that everyone wanted him to take, he would have set a tradition of dying in office, of our leaders dying in office. Except because of Washington, up until modern times, your times, Two was good enough for Washington, two was good enough for the presidents, and it kept as tradition. I would have voted for him a third time, though, of course. Especially because who replaced him but John Adams? Oh, John Adams. He's the one who called me the bastard in the newspapers, born to a Scottish peddler. My dad was from nobility. Okay, he was poor, though. But nonetheless, Adams and I did not get along. We were both Federalists, but Adams did not like how I became so powerful. There was one point during the quasi-war with France that we had to raise a national army, still under Washington. This is the year before he died, though. Washington's called out of retirement. He doesn't lead the army per se. He basically says, yes, I'm the head. You have the army. Good. Hamilton, thank you. Take charge. So I become the Inspector General of the Army. Washington goes home. So I'm basically number two in charge of the Army, number one, of course, being Adams. I'm the head of a 12,000-man army, which is larger than any army that Washington commanded during the Revolutionary War. So talk about being a powerful man of the day. So Adams really does not like how powerful I become. They don't like that I love Great Britain so much. They don't like that my banker friends are earning so much money from speculation on bonds. I am not earning a lot of money, but a lot of this is put out into local newspapers. And eventually, Adams and I have a split. There's no way that I can support him to be president again. His rotunditude of brain tree. And so, in the election of 1800, it is John Adams versus Thomas Jefferson. Now, back then, we also had that each president would choose their vice president. It's better to not just have the next person with the most electoral college votes. Make it an understanding. And so Thomas Jefferson had an understanding that he wanted to have Aaron Burr. This now came about because we, for the first time, had political parties. During Washington's day, it was Federalist and Anti-Federalist. Basically, you agree or you don't agree. But then the two parties were created, me being the head of the Federalist Party and Jefferson being the head of the Republican Party. The Republican Party believed in small government. They believed in an agrarian utopia where the government would leave everyone alone. Everyone can basically just grow crops, grow enough food to feed themselves and others, grow wheat for beer, grow flax for clothing, and that we can basically enjoy this life. That's a pipe dream. I realize that the way to live better is basically going to be through the Industrial Revolution, which is already happening in Great Britain, and it's going to happen here. And so the election comes down to a tie, but not between Jefferson and Adams, because I basically take half the Federalist Party and take it away from Adams. So now all those votes basically ended up voting for Jefferson and Jefferson's running mate for vice president, who basically is running for president, Aaron Burr. They tie. So with this election now, it goes to the House of Representatives. That's how you break a presidential tie. And so the whole House sits, they vote, and once again, it's a tie. They vote again, it's a tie. 35 times they vote, and it becomes a tie. Well, I credit myself with creating the Constitution, creating the Army, creating the Coast Guard, I'll take the Navy too. Creating our national currency, creating our national debt, creating our national debt, basically our credit. I'll pick the next president. Yeah, I can do that. So, is it going to be Jefferson or is it going to be Burr? I knew both of these gentlemen. Aaron Burr was actually a colleague of mine from New York. His law office was just right next door, a couple doors down. And he and I, though, well, okay, I'll say it. I despise the man. He has no morals. He's the type of man that would say anything to anyone for his own self-interest. No morals whatsoever. This man cannot be president. Jefferson, I disagree with Jefferson on virtually every single political stance and think the government should not go that way at all. But I respect the man. I know that he will do his job the way he thinks it's best done for the country and not himself. So I lay my weight behind Jefferson and get him elected president. You might have heard that Burr really took a qualm to that later on. A couple years later, we meet. See, Aaron Burr also did not, he ran then against, in the New York State, against my father-in-law, and he defeated my father-in-law for a New York Senate seat. And so that then became a problem. And then against, he ran for governor, and then I got him defeated for that. And we started making fun of each other in the newspapers, and eventually it came down to his honor was in disrepute. He blamed me. He called me out in letters. I tried to calm the situation. I have already been in 11 engagements of honor, and in not one has it resulted in us actually firing at each other. But with this case, Burr would accept nothing less. And so on one fateful day in 1804, we entered separate boats, rowed across the Hudson River to the plains of Weehawken, met 20 paces apart. I told my second that I was not going to kill him. I was just going, we're not there to kill each other. We're there to show that we are willing to die to defend our honor. That's the purpose of a duel. And yes, you might die. But I wasn't there to kill him. I told my second that, but before we actually fired, I did take out my glasses and put them on. Maybe Burr took that as a sign that I wanted to really see him. But when we eventually did shoot, I shot up in the air. But Burr shot straight through my liver, and I passed away about 36 hours later on. But I don't want to leave you on that sad note, because I've done so much great things. One of the great things I did was also to change Thomas Jefferson from who he thought he was. Yes, I'll take credit for that too. You see, when he was president now, one of the great things that he is noted for was the Louisiana Purchase. Where in the Constitution does it say that that the federal government can simply buy more land? Doesn't say that. So, a Republican basically would say that you cannot do that, and he argued that if it's not in the Constitution, you cannot do it. But he used the necessary and proper clause that I use so much, basically saying that this was necessary in order to enlarge our country, and that basically the government was expected to do that. That's the stretch that's the argument that I made. He took my argument. And then he used funds, which he would not have had his agrarian utopia been created. No, funds that were available from the Bank of the United States. Credit that was a result of my economic policies. Because of what I did, Jefferson was able to fulfill his greatness. And eventually America can become the great empire that it is today. Thank you for your time. Yes, the question is, wasn't my son killed in a duel? And yes, my eldest son, Philip, he was actually settling an affair of honor that somebody made disparaging remarks about myself. And I was grooming Philip to be my predecessor, just like Adams was grooming his eldest son. And so, unfortunately, though, it did go to a duel, and he was shot and killed.
Comments about what Mr. Callender wrote about you in the Richmond Gazette in 1797?
There was a woman by the name of Maria Reynolds who basically came to me one day and said that she was destitute, she had no money, she pleaded a sorry case. Okay, so I basically helped her out. And she came up with an ingenious way to repay me. Over 13 months, I received installments. And it was later that her husband, who was apparently not estranged, but basically he then came to me saying that he wants money in order to keep this quiet. I paid him. And then my detractors came to me and said that because Mr. Reynolds was also involved in some of that speculation that was going on with Revolutionary War debt, that I was helping him out and that funds were missing from the Treasury. And I basically said, no. It's nothing to do. I just gave him money because I slept with his wife. That's it. And I'm clearing up my honor. And so I wrote a great big story in another newspaper basically saying that my honor is intact. I only slept with some other man's wife. Okay, my bad.
Do you ever have siblings?
I have a brother, older brother named James. He never came to visit me. He was still down in the Caribbean. I invited him to my wedding. I wrote him letters. He was more than welcome. He never came to visit me. So yeah, eventually I just got a letter that he died. So we were, we didn't really keep in touch. Good question, though. Yes.
I know that your wife tried to tell your story after that he passed away, but it wasn't. She didn't live long enough to publish your biography. It was actually your son. Why do you think that your story was mostly untold until much more recently, like now?
The question is, why has my story not been properly told? And you do touch upon a lot of it, like the great stories that are told of Jefferson, Washington, Adams. They lived to retirement, Adams and Jefferson living into their 80s and 90s for Adams. And they had time in their retirement to create their autobiographies, to create their own libraries. They had decades to just basically write notes about what they want people to remember about them. So I died when I was 47. I didn't have the time. My family, though, being left with not much more than my name, my wife took up the cause. And then eventually further members of my family. There's an interesting part of the nature of American government and the duality between myself and Jefferson. When Thomas Jefferson is very popular, I am not. When I am very popular, Jefferson is not. I actually had a resurgence in America during the early 20th century. That's when I was placed on the $10 bill during the Coolidge administration. They were very pro-Federalist at the time, and so basically my popularity boomed. But then Jefferson basically, his popularity boomed after that. I think some stories with him and Sally Hemings caused him to then decline. And my story, partially thanks to Ron Chernow and the musical, is basically, I'm getting my due, finally. Yes. Yes.
Was there truth to the stories about you and your sister-in-law, Angelica?
I loved Angelica. And she loved me. We were kindred spirits. What went on between Angelica and Eliza? Who chose me? Why I ended up with Eliza? Be it that Angelica was more... I knew that Angelica wanted money and I didn't have it. Hence her marriage to Mr. Church. But I knew if she had a free heart that she would always remain close to us. And there was no problem in our relationship. We did have a beautiful triad. Mind you, you know of one word for love. The Greeks have three. Eros, philia, and agape. Eros is the romantic love. Philia is the love of family members. And then agape is the love of the common man. So Angelica's love for me was philia. Deep philia. Yes?
I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your life in New York City. Just living there, where you were, and
Sure. Well, I had two times in the city. Of course, in the very beginning, when I was a student, and that was amazing because everything is new, and I am, as a young man, creating my life at the same time that a country is being created, and I am so confident that I can realize that I can actually be a part to create this country, and it was really beyond my dreams that I will become one of, if not the major factor in directing the growth of this great country. But my time in New York, I spend a lot of it writing. I don't get out that much. I don't spend a lot of time with family. I'm on Wall Street, my office is in Wall Street. I wish I had more time to spend with my children. But even when I'm not in office, I'm writing letters. I'm pleading a case, pleading a law case, or pleading my case for the creation of America and or the direction of America. It was, I really didn't pay too much attention to the day-to-day life of America. I paid my attention to the life of America. Oh, I'm sorry, to the day-to-day life of New York. I spent my time dedicated to the life of America. Of course, I could talk at length at, you know, what a normal day is, but it's unremarkable to me because I live it. You know, it's a smelly defuge of dirty streets. I'm so happy that you have cleaned up. I can wear white again. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm not sure about if I heard this right. I went to Trinity Church yesterday, and I saw the monument for you, and I thought I heard someone say that this giant rectangular sarcophagus, like right next to it, was Burr's widow. Did I hear that right?
No, that's my wife, Eliza.
Oh, okay, yes. Okay, because it was unmarked. I couldn't read it. Okay, thanks.
Certainly. Yes.
How did you feel about the enslavement of people in the early America?
How did I feel about the enslavement of people? I, more than most New Yorkers, understood it on a deeper level because I came from slave society. Nevis and St. Croix were slave society. St. Croix was a big slave plantation, basically, the sugar plantations. It's horrible. But granted, we had slaves. When I was young, my mother had three slaves, but they were playmates of mine. They were friends. And so when my mother passed and they had to be sold, they were friends that were ripped away from me. And so it is the most devilish of evils that our country has kept, slavery in itself. It is beyond me to understand how the limited economic thought of the Southerners could not grow beyond what they had and dream of something better. And part of that idea led me to create the Manumission Society here in New York for the freeing of slaves. So I think more than any founding father worked diligently and actively, not just in theory like Jefferson or Washington, who freed his slaves upon his death, but during my lifetime to do what I could to lay my weight beyond or behind the ideas and powers to get slaves freed. Yes?
Considering you credited yourself with the founding of the Bank of New York, Mr. Burr is credited with the founding of the Chase Bank. Can you discuss a bit of the competitiveness between the two banks and what was your Bank of New York doing better or different than the Chase Bank?
Well, Mr. Burr, notice it's not called Burr's Bank.
No, it's not.
Yes, it's called Samuel Chase's Bank.
P. Chase, yes. But he is still credited as the founder.
Yes, obviously I'm reluctant to give Burr any credit that is due.
Seriously, could you discuss the relationship as a banker to one banker?
Yeah. We shared similar interests in getting banking acceptable. We both had problems early on with with speculation. One of the problems were that people had to, during the war, things had to be paid for, and we often didn't pay you with money, we paid you with IOUs, debts. Soldiers were paid with IOUs. And then all these people that wanted to, you know, paid with crops of IOUs, they wanted to cash it in when we created a national bank. But before then, a lot of them sold it to speculators for pennies on the dollar. And so now there becomes a big rift, and this is where the banks start to, the personality of a bank takes place in the decisions they make as to who they're going to support. There was one faction that wanted the original debt holders, the original soldiers or the original farmers that sold goods, to be paid the full value of what they were owed. But they sold it for, say, 15 cents on the dollar. And then to try to find A, that person, but then who they sold the debt to, and then the chain of all the people they set the debt to, sold the debt to, and to the last final person, that was just too difficult. So I liked that idea, but not the impracticality of it. It simply just was not possible. Conversely, I do support the idea that basically the final debt holder is the one who risked his capital. And he is working on his merits as to that debt that he bought for 15 cents on a dollar, it could go to 10, could go to 5. He took the chance, and so he should be rewarded for that. Now,
the difference between your philosophy and Mr. Burr's, was it different or was it complementary?
Burr, I tried to find the equality in the situation. I tried to look at both parties and settle it for the best of the American people as well as the investors. Burr would do what was better for Burr.
Ah, okay.
Simple as that.
I just wanted to get to that point. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
I think you must have been thrilled from the grave when you found that your son was defending Eliza Jamel in the divorce case with Aaron Burr.
Yes, yes. Yeah, there's an amazing, the amount of times that Burr's family and my family intertwined with each other, it's a destiny. It really is quite amazing. Aaron Burr was actually the man who came up to me in Manhattan during the beginning part of the war when I just met Washington. After I met Washington and Washington left, basically everyone left me. The British is coming, I still have my cannon, and it was Burr that was actually further north, and someone sent him on down. I think it was MacDougall sent him on down to basically say, oh, by the way, go get Hamilton. And he came on down, and this is the first time I met him, and he said, time to go. And so he actually gathered me together, and we headed on up. So it really is the Burr and Hamilton story. It's a beautiful story.
Horrible ending.
Yes.
Did you have aspirations to the presidency? And did your disgrace after the Mariah Reynolds affair maybe cause you to want to die in the end in your duel?
Did I have aspirations for the presidency? And did the Reynolds situation create a disgrace that permanently smudged my honor? The last part first, no, I'm just a man. And one thing that nobody did in my time was to say that you wanted to be president. The person who says, vote for me, I want to be president because I want the power, that's the person that you don't want to vote for. The presidents in my time did not run. They quietly talked to people. Quietly said, you know, yes, I want to run, just among friends, but it was not a public thing. There was no campaigning of the day. And so did I want to run for president? Yeah. I knew it. Eventually, I would. After the Reynolds fiasco, a lot of people thought that there was no possible way that I could be president, but give it 20 years later, give it 10. People forget. Once again, who's voting for me? Men. All I have to do is win them over. But in politics, there is a... People do forget about your previous indiscretions. Give it a couple of years. And it is quite amazing at what society can forgive a presidential candidate. Yes, question. Because I was not born in the United States, I could not be president. But I was a U.S. citizen prior to the Constitution being created. And so that's one of the gray areas that I did actually talk, because the question did come about. And so I did already put that forth going, without a doubt, I can be president. I was an American citizen when we created the Constitution, and that's the starting line. So we're talking about people born in America from the Constitution on outward. Any other questions? Yes.
Could you just go back to the IOUs a minute?
Yes.
In the end, what was decided? Did they pay the full IOU, or did they pay the 15 cents on the dollar, or somewhere in between?
In the end, it was market forces. In the end, I basically created, it was the final bearer of the notes. Mm-hmm. Then subsequently, because that was paid in that way, I then put out more bonds, created more debt. And because I honored the last person paying, I created this integrity in the banking system so that when the next bond issuance came out, all over Europe wanted our bonds. The value of the bonds jumped up 400%. In a matter of days or weeks. It was incredible. We went through bonds fiascos. Sometimes it crashed. We did have one crash during my lifetime when the speculation on the bonds became so incredible that eventually moneylenders simply said, no, I'm not going to lend you money to go buy bonds anymore. And then the price kind of collapsed. And then I had to kind of I stepped in. So there is a love of market forces, the laissez-faire attitude of the pure capitalism, which exists in some minds in colonial society. I was not one of them. I do not believe in pure laissez-faire capitalism. I believe that capitalism should be directed for the best efforts of its citizens. And so I then, for example, the bond went up to almost $2,000, and then it collapsed down to $400. Those numbers are a little bit off, but to give you an idea, I then set on a price of saying it's worth $1,200, and that's what the federal government would pay you for. So I became superior to market forces, but for the benefit of society. And hopefully, society will see that that balance of market forces, which is what originally happened with the first bondholders from the war. They thought, you know, I have this, I can't turn it in, they're going to give me money later, or I can get a little bit of money now. They decided to get a little money now. They could have waited, it was their choice, and I let that market force last. So I did play both sides of the aisle in that regard.
In different cases.
In different cases, yes.
Different,
yes. Always working for the best of the citizens of the country, not the one person as a whole. And never, ever in my self-interest. I never gained financially from my dealings as Secretary of Treasury. I think it's very important for people to know.
What was the interest rate back then?
Oh, give me 5 seconds and I'll tell you a different number. The question is, what is the interest rate back then? It fluctuated tremendously because bond price and interest rate, they fluctuate in opposite sides to each other. It all depends, and each bond was different.
Okay.
Yes.
Idea for the federal government to assume the debts of the state, part of a financial plan or part of a way to get them to accept and ratify the Constitution?
Oh, yes. There's a lovely story if you have a couple of moments. The grand plan, basically, one night, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, my little friend, eventually he didn't like me. He spent too much time with Jefferson. He has his own room in Jefferson's house in Monticello, James Madison. It's amazing. They're both Virginians and neighbors. But at this time, Madison is starting to go into Jefferson's camp. And this is at the right when we've declared, right when we've accepted our Constitution. The Capitol is still in New York City, and I am trying to get the federal government to assume all the state government's debt. So in this, it works a little bit good for the north and not so good for the south. I use an example of men and women. If you are the northern states, and let's say during the war, because the British were in control of the northern states, you were not able to engage in trade, you didn't have a lot of money, you couldn't raise taxes, so you had to borrow money to send to me and to Washington for the troops. Let's say you borrowed $1,000 each. Gentlemen, you're the northern states. Ladies, you're more agricultural society, you were still able to grow things, sell things, you had money, you sent it to us, you only gained about $100 in debt. Now, my plan was to take all of those state debts collected under a federal debt. But because it's federal, you still have to pay your fair share of it. And so in the plan, when it averages out to about $550 per state, gentlemen, you used to owe $1,000, now you owe $550. Still a pretty good deal. Not too bad. But for the ladies, you used to owe $100. Now the federal government's telling you owe $550. Do you like this plan? Well, I definitely know how to keep the ladies happy. And so, jewelry works well. So we decided to give them the crown jewel of American society, the U.S. Capitol. So there was an agreement made that we moved the capital from New York, which basically has the idea of bankers and mischievous men, and move it further south, down to the Potomac, down to Virginia, on land that Washington chose, about 20 miles north of his house at Mount Vernon, as far up the Potomac River as you can navigate a ship. And so we started building that federal city in 10 years, but we moved the capital from New York to Philadelphia for those 10 years. And so that was the great compromise on how I was able to get them in on this deal. And I think I got the better part of this deal by far. Not only did I basically create a debt, which basically is the way that you establish how good of a country you are. Now, conversely, with this debt, foreign nations could buy our debt. When they own our debt, they are less likely to invade us because then the debt becomes worthless. So they have skin in the game. And I knew that. I learned that from Great Britain. I learned that from Smith, the economist. And I'm very happy that I got what I wanted. And by the way, the banks remained in New York. Yes.
You spoke of most of your life achievements, such as like starting with your big, but you did mention founding the New York Post. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, that was nice. it's not as shiny. Of course, if I was going to give credit to anyone for really starting the Post, started going off on Franklin for a second about post office. You were talking about the newspaper. Newspapers of the day. That's like owning a newspaper of the day. It's almost like your son coming home and saying he wants to be an actor. Actors you don't trust. Why? They're professional liars. That's what they do. You don't want to be an actor. Newspapers of the day. It was not with news. It's really opinions. That's really what they are. You can write whatever you want in the age of yellow journalism. You can write whatever you want in our newspapers, and you don't even have to sign your name. And so it was a necessity to have, because this was my social media outlet. And so in order to put information out there, I now control this channel of information, so I can not be the writer of every single article, but solicit friends and control this information and control where it's going to. So it's more control of the information, but I'm not necessarily proud of it in the fact of standing up for what newspapers stood for, because that could be bought and sold.
Mr. Hamilton. Treasury is tanking, and the election is in question.
I have work to do.
You have work to do on the second floor.
I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen.